Delighted to have you all here with us this afternoon. I'm Lorraine Branham. I'm the Dean of the SI Newhouse School of Public Communications at Syracuse University. And it's my great pleasure to welcome you to our 6th annual Mirror Awards. So great to have you all in the room. And you know what is really amazing about today, other than the fact that you all are here, is that the weather in Syracuse is actually better than the weather in New York today. Sunshine and blue skies all day today. And those of you who went to Newhouse understand how rare that can be. We are truly delighted to have all of you here to celebrate with us these awards, which the Newhouse School established to shine a light on the media industry. And today we honor the very best in media reporting, and we recognize achievement and innovation over the past year. But this is not just a day for accolades and self-congratulations. The ability of the media to critique and evaluate its own work is more important than ever in this era of information overload and 24-hour news cycles. We who cover and report on everyone else must be just as diligent about covering ourselves. And in fact, I would argue that media credibility is dependent on this self-scrutiny and self-examination. It is our hope that the Mirror Awards will continue to encourage and strengthen reporting in this area. I'll get off my soapbox now. There are many people to thank today. I'm sure I will miss some, and let me apologize in advance for that. But first, I must thank the members of the industry who are assembled here, and especially our headline sponsors, as well as our luncheon co-chairs, David Zaslav, the President and CEO of Discovery Communications, David Levy, President of Sales, Distribution, and Sports for the Turner Broadcasting System, and Melinda Whitmer, President and Chief Video and Content Officer of Time Warner, Inc. Their support has made this recognition event possible. Next, I'd also like to thank the many alumni and friends of the school who served as judges and organizers for the Mirrors, some of whom are here today. You also have our gratitude. We're also delighted to have as our special guests today members of the Syracuse University Board of Trustees and members of the Newhouse Advisory Board. I'm delighted that they could join us as well. I also want to thank and recognize our scholarship partners in the room, CNN, Turner Broadcasting, and Discovery Communications. While some in the industry talk about diversity, these two companies have walked the walk, and it has made a difference not only in our classrooms but in their workplaces. Thank you both for working with us to make diversity in this industry a reality. And last but by no means least, I'd like to thank my staff, who do all the hard work to make this event possible, and especially Jean Brooks and her assistants. Thank you, Jean. Now, you all know that the Newhouse School is widely considered to be among the most prestigious communication programs in the country. And most of you know the school by the reputation of our graduates, who hold prominent positions throughout the industry. Now we are training the next generation of media leaders. These students are the academic all-stars. They could go anywhere and be anything. And we are all fortunate that these young storytellers, aspiring journalists, and budding entrepreneurs are choosing the communications business. I could go on and on about the school, but I'd rather show you what we do up there. Thank you. We're delighted to have some of our students and recent grads here today. I think you may have met some of them already. Ladies and gentlemen, if you happen to have any empty seats at your table, it would be great if you would allow us to fill it with some of these hungry and pun intended students. So just raise your hand and they will find their way over to your table. Thank you. As many of you know, the Mirror Awards were the brainchild of the school's former board chair, the late Fred Dressler, the chief programming officer at Time Warner. It's a yearly pleasure to have this opportunity to gather and remember him. Fred would be so pleased to see how this program has grown over time, and indeed, this year it is growing again. This is our largest gathering yet, with a broader and more diverse pool of entries than ever before. And in this business, nothing says we love you more than cold, hard cash. And thanks to the generosity of longtime partners, Discovery Communications and Time Warner Cable, our categories will now carry cash prizes. The most distinguished of these we inaugurate this year. We are pleased, very pleased, to announce the John M. Higgins Award for Best In-Depth Enterprise Reporting. And we're even more pleased to have members of John's family, his widow Debbie, his brother Bill, and Bill's wife here with us today. We're so pleased that you could join us to honor and recognize him with this award. Many of you knew John, one of the most respected journalists of his time. He died in 2006 at the age of 45, far too soon. We're instituting this award this year with a special tribute to him later in the program. A few ground rules before we get started. Our well-known presenters need no introduction, and so I won't bother to introduce them. You can read their bios in our program. But we are particularly grateful to Anderson Cooper for serving as our MC today. Thank you, Anderson. But before we put him to work, we want to give him a few minutes to eat. Happily, we know that the rest of you can listen, eat, and tweet simultaneously. I've seen Arianna Huffington's already been tweeting. Speaking of tweeting, please add our hashtag, Mirrors12, that's Mirrors12, to your tweets today. Now enjoy your meal. Please save some room for dessert, courtesy of Georgetown Cupcakes. Dessert so good, they're even the star of the show, DC Cupcakes. And in about 15 minutes, we'll get started with the presentation of the Mirror Awards. Bon appetit.
Thanks very much. If everybody could just take their cupcakes and settle into a sugar high. I'm really delighted to be here. As you all know, the purpose of the Mirror Awards is to focus attention on the important roles that the media plays in our society. Our entries this year cover the intersection of media and politics, technology, economic news, and pop culture. For better and worse, this past year was a year that prompted certainly a lot of reflection in all of our newsrooms across the world. From the News of the World phone hacking scandal to the new capabilities of social media, their often troubling implications on privacy and content ownership, all of us have been questioning both the motives and the tactics for gathering news and information. All of us have been debating the degree to which women and other traditionally marginalized voices have made inroads in a media marketplace that's dominated by, well, frankly, by white men, who are certainly well represented here today as well. Woo, white men. The question, of course, we're all asking is how can we challenge our industry and society at large to do better? And our industry continues to adapt uneasily to the role of the citizen journalist. By the way, please don't tweet that, woo, white man. Cooper says, woo, white man. I just realizing that's not going to really go well on Twitter. Ariana, take your hand off that friggin' keyboard. At least explain it. Give some context, please. This year's entry has really discussed how the media can balance the technological capabilities available to anyone with a cell phone with journalistic judgment, discretion, and skill. And certainly there was a lot to talk about this past year and plenty to celebrate here today. And we have some remarkable people to celebrate and to honor today. The competition this year, in case you didn't know, was bigger than ever before with more diverse voices, I'm happy to say. Among the 31 finalists nominated today, we have a man from Pakistan, a reporter who reflects on a political climate in which he and his fellow journalists have to tread very carefully. We have an investigative entry from a student newspaper at Northwestern University, two articles which challenge American coverage of Middle Eastern turmoil, and a series of commentaries which told readers, among other things, that it was their social responsibility to see the film Bridesmaids, which I actually heartily agree with. And if you haven't seen the film Bridesmaids, you should feel ashamed. We're now down to the seven winners that we're about to announce. So congratulations to all those who were finalists and all those nominated. Our first category is, this is gonna roll off the tongue, it's Best Profile Digital Media for a Carefully Researched Piece Dealing with a Single Person or Organization Noteworthy in the Media Industry. We gotta work on these titles, I think, just a little bit. The finalists are Danny Gold, the man who makes money publishing your nude pics, the All. And yes, I looked at George Stephanopoulos when I said your nude pics. Joe Pompeo, the road ahead for the Huffington Post, Capital New York. Rachel Sklar, Chelsea Handler has it covered, change the radio. And the Mirror Award goes to Joe Pompeo, Capital New York. Joe, come on up here. Joe's article detailed the Huffington Post merger with AOL. Judges described it as deeply reported and thought-provoking, as well as a richly informational look inside. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Like the quick photo before you say something.
So last year, a profile about Capital New York was nominated in the same category, and that was exciting. But this is more exciting. So I'd like to thank the Mirror Award judges for that. I'd also like to thank my editor, Tom McGeverin, who really shaped this piece into what it was. And I'd like to thank, really, everyone who spoke with me for this article, because really without them there would be no article. And congratulations to my fellow finalists in the category. Thank you.
Thank you. Congratulations. Our next category is Best Commentary, Traditional / Legacy Media, designed to honor those writers who in three pieces demonstrate overall knowledge of their beat, analytical skills, and unique voice. Here are our finalists today. Eric Alterman, The Nation. How low will the Washington Post go? How Rupert Murdoch buys friends and influences people. I didn't say that, that was Eric Alterman. The agony and ecstasy and disgrace of Steve Jobs. Also, Syed Irfan Ashraf, The Dawn Media Group, Individual Land. His article is Cost of Self-Censorship, Media's Apologetic Professionals, and a Synthetic Image. Also nominated, John Gapper, Financial Times. Huffington is Right to Take the Cash, The Conflict of Interest in Free News, Innovators Don't Ignore Customers. Also finalist, Anna Holmes, The New York Times, The Washington Post, The Disposable Woman, Anna Holmes on Donald Trump's sexism. Is Donald Trump here? The best TV criticism, ink is pink but powerful. And the Mirror Award goes to Anna Holmes for her work in The New York Times and The Washington Post. Anna's pieces pose challenges to gender norms within the media. One judge described her work as great reporting on key topics, very well argued, with lively detail. Thanks. Hey, congratulations.
Thank you. I wrote some notes in case I won, and I did, and I'm happy to say thanks to Mark Lotto, formerly of the New York Times, now of GQ, for being an amazing, rigorous, incisive, and encouraging editor. To my two editors at the Washington Post, Ned Martell and Nicole Arthur. And I just wanted to say that I think that maybe this award speaks to a growing excitement around the thoughtful, sharp critiques about how the country's politics, particularly its gender and racial politics, are reflected in our pop culture. Slowly but surely, we're seeing the diversity of American experiences, particularly those involving women and people of color, begin to be more adequately represented in both the media we consume and in the media about the media we consume. Yay, white men.
You can tweet that, by the way. Anna Holmes says, yay, white men.
One of the three pieces that I was nominated for was actually about this very subject, how some of the most exciting, incisive, and provocative commentary today is being done by female cultural critics. And those writers, along with a lot of political reporters who happen to be female, are changing the conversation, and in the words of Rachel Sklar, another nominee today, changing the ratio. Thanks.
Our next category is Best Profile Traditional Legacy Media. The finalists are Ken Auletta, Changing Times, The New Yorker, Felix Gillette, Demand Media's Planet of the Algorithms, Bloomberg Businessweek, Vanessa Gregoriadis, Maharishi Arianna, New York Magazine, Evan Osnos, The Hound Dynasty, The New Yorker. And the mirror goes to Ken Auletta, The New Yorker. Ken's profile and Jill Abramson of The New York Times impressed our judges across the board. One judge described as well-reported, eloquently delivered, an intimate but not sentimental portrait. Hey, congratulations.
Just a few people to thank. The Newhouse School, the Newhouses, my editor Nick Thompson at The New Yorker, who did a great job, and we've lost him to the website, which he got a nice promotion, and to the other finalists who did a great job and deserve to be up here with me. Thank you.
Our next category is Best Single Article Traditional Legacy Media. And the next category, the nominees are Jody Enda, Politico Act II, American Journalism Review, Felix Gillette, again, The Rise and Inglorious Fall of MySpace, Bloomberg Businessweek, Adam Leshinsky, How Apple Works, and Fortune, and Gabrielle Sherman, The Elephant in the Green Room, New York Magazine. Also, Emily Steele and Jeffrey A. Fowler, big brands like Facebook, but they don't like to pay, The Wall Street Journal. And the Mirror Award goes to Adam Leshinsky, How Apple Works, Fortune. Adam's piece on Apple was, in our judges' words, ambitious, well-reported, prescient, told with fly-in-the-wall detail. Here to accept his award on behalf is Stephanie Maida, the executive editor for Fortune magazine.
Thank you. Adam couldn't be here today. He's based on the West Coast, and he asked me to just thank a few people on his behalf. First of all, I wanted to take an opportunity to tell you what a great journalist Adam is. It's a real honor for me to be up here accepting the award for him. He's a world-class journalist, and it certainly showed in his piece on Apple. Adam specifically wanted us to thank Andy Serwer, our managing editor, who's been a great advocate for technology journalism in the magazine. He also wanted to thank Doris Burke, who is a senior reporter and works with him very closely on all of his Apple coverage. And frankly, Doris works on all our big stories. She's terrific. Adam also wanted to thank John Corpix, our former creative director, who really pushed us hard on the graphics and visuals on this story. Armin Harris, the photo editor on the story, who, as Adam put it, worked as hard as anybody trying to get photos of a company that refuses to participate in any photography. And Nick Varshaver, who was a sounding board for the story, and Hank Gilman, deputy managing editor, who's also been a great advocate for our coverage of technology. Thanks.
Now for the Mirror Award for Best Single Article Originally Published Online. The finalists are Joshua Benton, that was quick, Neiman Journalism Lab, Paul Ford, Facebook and the Epiphanator, An End to Endings, New York Magazine, Lauren Kirchner, AOL Settled with Unpaid Volunteers for $15 million, Columbia Journalism Review, and Rhonda Roland Shearer and Malik Ayub Sambal, Mrs. Bhutto's Murder Anniversary Part 1, iMedia Ethics. Also, Mallory Jean Tenner, In Real Time, Journalist Tweets Contribute to a Raw Draft of History, Pointer. And today, the Mirror Award goes to Rhonda Roland Shearer and Malik Ayub Sambal, iMedia Ethics. Rhonda and Malik's piece challenged American journalistic practices on the topic of foreign victims. Judges described their piece as fascinating, a very comprehensive treatment of a provocative and important topic that rarely receives this depth of attention, replete with great sourcing. Hey, congratulations. I'll hold on. Sure. Okay.
Don't want to drop it. Well, I'm amazed. This is kind of a David and Goliath. I so admire the other finalists. These are all our heroes at iMedia Ethics. I want to point out that our whole staff that worked on this article, absent Malik, who sends his thanks and gratitude from Pakistan, is at a back table. We've got Sydney Smith, please stand up. We've got David Moore, who's part of our team. He's a pollster. We have Alan Bisbord, who is editor on this piece, and Sam Eifling, who spent hours helping with producing the piece that you see. And we have Pat Shannon, who is line editor. We had in the piece also an interactive map that was produced by Robert Slavinsky. So essentially, we're a small publication, but we are very careful and try to model ourselves after the larger media outlets. And it's a struggle because we're not for profit, and we try to express our dedication best we can, but we are experiencing, just like the bigger news outlets, a difficulty. But I want to thank the Newhouse School, the Newhouse family. I also want to thank the wonderful staff of the Mir Awards and the judges with their dedication for all the time that's taken. And I just want to thank all of you for being dedicated to something that's really often a thankless job, because when you actually question or challenge journalists, they move from suddenly being journalists to being sources, acting just like sources act. So it's a very lonely place, so at least I know I have some friends here, because it often feels very friendless and very lonely. So thank you very much.
That was great. Congratulations. Adam Leshinsky left his card up here, but anyway. Get it to him. For best commentary, digital media, the finalists are Gavin Pallone, Vulture.com, Why TV Networks Don't Need to Worry About Netflix and Hulu's Original Programming. That's a relief. Pallone's four-step plan for saving NBC. Pallone's Hollywood cost-cutting solution number two, stop the pricey producer deals. Also, Rem Ryder, American Journalism Review, The Incredible Shrinking Rupert, The Wall Street Journal careens off the rails, passing on rumors. Jack Schaefer, Reuters blog, The Trial of Stephen Glass, Who Gets to be Anonymous, The apotheosis of Steve Jobs. Mallory Jean Tenner from Pointer, How Accessible Do Journalists Really Want to Be? Journalists value precise language except when it comes to describing minorities, and have newsrooms relax standards, sanctions for fabrication and plagiarism. Also, Rebecca Traister, Salon, New York Times Magazine, The Soap Opera is Dead, Long Live the Soap Opera. 30 Rock takes on feminist hypocrisy and its own. Seeing Bridesmaids is a social responsibility. And the Mirror Award goes to Rebecca Traister for her work for Salon and the New York Times Magazine. Rebecca, described as a modern, hugely funny writer, is characterized by one judge. She gives a close-up analysis of soap operas, 30 Rock, and Bridesmaids, including a broader discussion of their societal impact and also the roles and presentation of women. The pieces were described as insightful, witty, as well as important. Congratulations. Do you have a favor, stand over here? Yeah, we gotta just.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Oh man, thank you so much to the Newhouse School and to all the Mirror judges. I just wanna say how much I admire everybody else in my category and actually all the nominees in so many of the other categories. I want to thank my editor, Carrie Lauerman, at Salon, which has been my home for almost 10 years at this point, and Greg Veese at the New York Times Magazine, who both of whom gave me space to say what I think and also editorial guidance to make it better. I also want to say something really personal, which is unusual for me, a personal thanks. One of the reasons that I'm really so stunned and pleased to get this award is because it's for work done in the year after I had my first kid. And I think that, like a lot of parents, mothers, and increasingly fathers, a lot of this year was spent with me saying, oh my God, I'm never going to work again. And the person who actually made it possible for me to work is our family's babysitter, Marion Bell. And without the very hard and great work that she does, I wouldn't have had the time to string three sentences together. So thank you very, very much, Marion.
We should have a babysitter category, actually. That would be amazing. And now for our last juried category, the John M. Higgins Award for Best In-Depth Enterprise Reporting. Here to inaugurate this award is managing partner with Intermedia Partners, Leo Hendry. Was left. Okay. You got a rocking tune there.
Right. Dave Zaslav picked that tune just for me. I'm just one of a number of friends of John Higgins here today, and my comments are offered on all of our collective behalf. Anderson, thank you for what you're doing for all of us today. But I would first like to thank and acknowledge John's family, who loved him so. And of course, like everyone else, it's a privilege to do anything related to the Newhouse School, to the Newhouse family, and Time Warner Cable, Discovery, who made this particular award so special and going forward possible every year hereafter. Like all of those of us who are friends of John's, I'm humbled to be introducing this award precisely because it's John's award. And like all of you, I have this abiding respect for journalists. I've had it my entire career in the industry, and John was certainly reflective of everything good in this industry. I first knew John, as many of you had, as the subject of his exceptionally rigorous but always fair journalism. Mark Robichaud asked me to stick in the phrase, always fair. But it wasn't long thereafter, and it was actually very short, that John became for me, like he has for so many of you, a cherished friend, and I miss him like you do every day of my life. At 45 years, he was taken from us far, far too early. And in my particular case, how can you not love the man, the one man who, after I'd won a major international car race, was the fellow who picked me up for dinner and bought me several stiff drinks as I got my obligatory tattoo. And as I said to Maura Higgins, John's beloved sister, there is nobody else in this room who knew where to go for my tattoo other than John Higgins. Mark helped me understand even more than I could have on my own that John was born, as we know, with ink in his veins. He was the most independent thinker that I've run across in this industry. He was completely unswayed by power and privilege. And he was known by his colleagues and by those of us whom he covered as, frankly, one of the smartest in the business, as I said a bit ago. John Higgins's work always reflected the very best, the very highest ideals of journalism. For those of you who didn't know him personally, it was a loss that you didn't. But a friend of mine and friend of many of those of us in the room said that John made his way through a crowd like a nearsighted black bear through thick underbrush. Remember that, a nearsighted black bear through thick underbrush. I see that, Debbie, on the tombstone. John was every bit of that. Was he heavy set? Oh, he was heavy set. He had a mustache always. And those thick glasses, absolutely. The same black suit, the same white shirt, the same black tie every day of his working life. And when John and his similarly garbed best friend, most cherished friend, Mark Robichaud, would come to interview you, you thought the Blues Brothers, John Belushi in the lead, had descended into your office. To John Higgins, and I quote, to John Higgins, there were two types of stories. There were the no shit stories and the holy shit stories. And as his beloved family and Debbie will tell you, and all of us who are on one end or the other, he much, much preferred the latter, those holy shit stories. And God help you if you thought that knowing John was going to give you an easy ride. I was the target of the uneasy rides more often and the pain than I can care to describe. Whether I was interviewed on or off the record, I always knew, however, that sitting across from me was the most consummate journalist that I would ever encounter in my career. But as bad as he was in one-on-one, it was those press conferences where he was surrounded by Mark and David and Tom and others, where he could sort of hide in the masses and let you have it. Yet John, despite a gruff exterior, Dave Zasloff, I can't see if Dave's already left us, but there wasn't a time when I called John where he didn't say, Higgins. And he was gruff, to say the least. But he possessed a humanity that is so rare in our industry at all times, but perhaps most particularly rare today. It was that fairness, that rareness, that turned John into the toughest critic, turned his toughest critics into his friends, and his best sources as well into his friends. But perhaps his most enduring legacy was his oft-stated belief that whoever you worked for, whether it was the Times or a blog, Vanity Fair or a trade magazine, you in this room, he in his own way could practice excellence. There's a continuing need, as all of us know, for precisely this sort of journalism, and it's gratifying to see the Newhouse School, the Newhouse family, Time Warner Cable, and Discovery put together and create in this award in John's honor, in John's memory, especially in the face of shrinking budgets, as we've heard this afternoon, and frankly, shrinking staffs as well. The John Higgins Award will be an annual award from here on out. It's a $5,000 reward presented annually to a journalist whose submitted piece best reflects John's hallmark in-depth and his wonderful, wonderful enterprise reporting. We have a wonderful film on John's career through the eyes of some other people, many of you in this room, who knew and loved him as I did. And so here's a tribute to our dear friend, John Higgins.
John's death cheats us out of about 20 years of excellent media coverage.
This is hysterical. It's the first time I've ever seen a company try to brand a layoff. They dropped from first place to fourth with absolutely incredible speed.
John was so smart, and he could dissect a balance sheet better than any reporter I've ever known. He knew everyone in the industry. He had great sources. He didn't take no for an answer.
The most powerful people in the media business, when John got up to ask a question at a press conference, you would see their body language physically change.
He didn't suffer fools. You know, it's easy to run with a story that you're pitched. Higgins never ran with a story he was pitched.
Nobody could spin him because he understood the numbers, he understood the research, he understood everything about the television and the media industry.
And everybody knew that when Higgins reported on something, he really went to the core of what was going on, whether it was good or bad.
He was always right. Like, he just didn't get it wrong. You may not like what he reported about you, but he was right.
The other Hall of Famer is an inductee, one of BNC's most talented reporters, and one of my best friends, John Higgins. Peaceful, patient, diplomatic. None of these things describe the John Higgins I knew.
So I first knew him as a competitor in terms of just being first, being more thorough, and that was Higgins.
He was a fantastic writer. He could write an article that a senior executive would read, a CEO would read, an analyst would read on Wall Street, and also the person sitting next to you at a coffee shop could read and understand. He had a way of synthesizing details, weaving anecdotes with factual information.
John also broke most of all the big stories of the day, and there was a lot of them, and it was no holes barred.
He would run into my office, and there would be something buried on the 76th page, down in a footnote, that no one else would have found. And he would just go, can you believe it? Can you believe what these bastards are trying to pull off? And boom, we'd have a page one story.
Most mornings would start off early. Usually it would be I'd call him, and I'd hear that same sound. Higgins. That's the way he answered the phone. And we talk. We talk about the industry, who was doing what was really happening. He was a real reporter, a gumshoe reporter.
With John, it would be more like, you know, hey, Tom, what's up? What's going on? He had a very friendly personality. He connected with people on many levels.
When I came in as editor-in-chief of broadcasting and cable, the first week Comcast announces they're going to make a bid for Disney. I mean, my head's swimming. Meanwhile, John Higgins, who's more wired than anybody in the business, is fielding calls from the Comcast guys. They're calling him from the jet as they crisscross the country, trying to get updates on how this story's playing on Wall Street. I mean, Higgins was amazing.
Higgins was like a human Facebook. He had a memory for everyone he would meet, where they used to work.
I discovered that beneath the hard candy shell, there was a soft, gooey center. And what a great, nice guy he really was.
He loved this industry, really, really, he loved it.
John's legacy is truly to bring truth to power, to have that legacy to award with John's name, those reporters out there who really stick their neck out to dig deep and to bring out the truth. I mean, that's what it's all about.
As you can see, whether it was Mark or Max or Allison or David or anybody else who could have participated in that film, we loved him to death. Although I swear, Max, the picture, the first time you spoke, the picture that followed of John after that had to have been a mugshot. I swear to God. The finalists for the John M. Higgins Award for Best In-Depth Enterprise Reporting are Jody Enda, The Bloomberg Juggernaut for the American Journalism Review, On the Media Team by Brooke Gladstone, Bob Garfield, Katya Rogers, Nazanin Rafsanjani, Jameson York, Mike Vuolo, and Sarah Abdurrahman, PJ Voigt, and Alex Goldman for Does NPR Have a Liberal Bias? I think so. And WNYC's On the Media. Peter Moss for The Toppling. Peter's from The New Yorker and ProPublica. Seth Mnookin, The Kingdom and the Paywall for New York Magazine. Brian Rosenthal for In Focus and Dismantling of a Legacy, The Rise and Fall of David Protes from The Daily Northwestern. Peter Taz, I think we got Peter Taz twice. I'm sorry. Those are our nominees. And Peter, I jumped the gun on you. I'm not good with these teleprompters. The winner of today's award is Peter Moss. Oh, God. Thank God Higgins isn't here today.
Thank you very much. It doesn't matter what you call me. I will come to the stage when it's meant for me. So thank you very much. I want to thank the Newhouse School, and I want to thank, obviously, it's a particular honor, the first John Higgins Award to be awarded that. And I also want to thank the Marines, the 3rd Battalion, 4th Marines, and they're the ones who gave me most of the information that made it possible to write this story that I wrote about the toppling of the statue of Saddam Hussein, how this icon, this media icon, was created. And then because I kind of wrote a story behind the story, just for a minute here, I just want to explain the story behind this particular story, which is that when I first wanted to do it, when I first had the idea to do it, I went to a number of publications And they all said, or most of them said, really good idea, but we just can't commit to it quite yet. And so I had to go to kind of the nonprofit route, and I was able to get a fellowship at the Shorenstein Center at Harvard University, for which I need to thank Alex Jones a lot. And then once I was able to do the research there, I went to ProPublica and was able to get additional support to finish the reporting, to do the writing, to get the editing done on the story that it needed. And for that, I need to thank Steve Engelberg and Paul Steiger and Tom Detzel, my editor. And most of all, in terms of thanks, is my wife, Alyssa Quart, who is also yet another editor involved in all of this. There are a lot of editors standing behind me virtually. And the point of kind of me mentioning ProPublica and Shorenstein Center, and then, of course, The New Yorker and David Remnick, thank you very much for publishing this monster of a story, is just to point out the real importance for me, for writers like me, of nonprofits and nonprofit journalism. It's really hard these days, harder than it used to be, to get kind of serious, not necessarily sexy stories written that require a lot of time, a lot of effort, a lot of travel. And that's why for somebody like me, the existence of ProPublica and the other nonprofits is so amazingly important. And to me, one of the shocking things actually now is, particularly here in New York, I just asked Steve, I said, are there any other major nonprofit news organizations in New York? This is the media capital of the world. This is, you know, the largest concentration of wealth perhaps in the world. And I think the answer is no. And ProPublica itself exists in New York. It was founded with West Coast money from the Sandler family, bless them. And I just kind of wanted to maybe, you know, just leave this by saying, we need more ProPublicas. We need more Pulitzer Centers for Crisis Reporting. We need more Centers for Investigative Reporting, more Texas Tribunes, and particularly based here in New York with the vast amount of wealth, some of which is here in this room, that exists. And so let's just make more of these flowers bloom. Thank you all very much.
I gotta say, I'm kind of curious about what tattoo Leo Hendry got. Do you want to show? No? All right, maybe next year. Finally this year, the I3 Award for Impact, Innovation, and Influence. This award is given by the school to recognize an organization or an individual who's captured the public's and the industry's imagination about the potential or the importance of the media in a very unique way. Here to present the award to the Knight Foundation's Alberto Ibarguen is co-anchor of ABC's Good Morning America, host of ABC's This Week, and ABC's chief political correspondent, George Stephanopoulos.
Fully clothed, I want to thank you, Anderson, for nominating me for Danny Gold's website. My GMA producers think it's an excellent idea. I'm really glad it closed. The I3 Award stands for Influence, Impact, and Innovation. It goes to an organization or an individual who captured the public's imagination for what media can do. CNN and YouTube won for bringing video to presidential debates, Blue State Digital for changing political campaigns, and Foursquare for linking cyberspace to physical space. This year, for the first time, a foundation has won the I3 Award, the John S. and James L. Knight Foundation of Miami, Florida, for redefining the role philanthropy can play in media innovation. In the past 10 years, Knight Foundation's investment in journalism and media innovation has exceeded $300 million. No other journalism grantmaker today has that kind of influence. You know, I feel it all the time because my Washington home for this week is the Knight Studio at the museum. The International Center for Journalists, all of you know the work they do and the journalists, the courageous journalists they recognize around the world, and there is Knight again as the organization's largest funder. Knight brings its digital edge to many different programs. It has a network of endowed journalism chairs and training programs reaching thousands of students and professionals, and the best-known e-learning with highschooljournalism.org and newsu.org. Knight funded Sunshine Week to fight for freedom of information, and Knight's report on the information needs of communities sparked the FCC's interest in that issue. Knight Foundation stands for informed and engaged communities. Its impact in communities provides better access to broadband, improved digital and media literacy, new tools to engage people in civic affairs, and even new ways to start nonprofit news organizations. Its Knight Community Information Challenge has helped bring hundreds of community foundations into news and information grant making. The Carnegie Knight Initiative for the Future of Journalism Education has helped leading journalism schools change the way they teach in the digital age. Early on, the Knight Foundation created a contest to spur media innovation, the Knight News Challenge. It's produced tools and techniques now used by hundreds of newsrooms and thousands of journalists. The News Challenge showed that anyone from 20-something computer programmers to the staff of the Associated Press can and should try to shape the future of news. At a time when many devalue journalism, Knight's open R&D helps both the profit and nonprofit sectors come face to face with journalism's future. It is with pride that I present to a partner and a colleague the I3 Award to Knight Foundation's president and CEO, Alberto Ibarguen. Congratulations.
Thank you very much, George. Thanks for coming down from Washington to honor the vision of the founders of Knight Foundation, Jack and Jim Knight. I'm very proud to receive this from George Stephanopoulos and delighted that he's back at the Knight Studios at the museum hosting ABC every Sunday morning. Thanks as well to Syracuse University. We know and admire the Newhouse School and the dean and its dean, Lorraine Branham. Our Knight Chair in Political Reporting, Charlotte Grimes, is there, as is Dan Pacheco, a past grantee of Knight Foundations, who is the new Professor of Innovation at the school. Thank you all for being here, and in particular, thanks to Ariana Huffington and Craig Newmark for coming out to support Knight today. As president of a foundation that champions informed and engaged communities, I've admired the way Ariana has built HuffPo into a true engagement engine, and Craig Newmark has done more, as much as anyone I know, to create a sense of place and belonging to community. Today's award may seem unlikely. Steve Waldman noted as we were coming in that he couldn't imagine a foundation winning for innovation. Yet here we are. Many of our partners are here, the New York Times, Columbia Journalism School, the Associated Press, the City University, WNYC, and more. They're at table number 7, which is hosted by my colleague, Eric Newton, who started many of our best journalism programs and who now is senior advisor. Is a trusted colleague and deserves the credit for this award. As much as Eric and I do appreciate the recognition, we also think our best innovations are still ahead of us. If the cutting edge is good, bleeding edge is better, and that's where we want to be. We've structured our team and leadership to ensure we keep pushing. Our new head of journalism and media innovation is Michael Maness, the former corporate vice president for innovation at Gannett. He's joined by new media director John Bracken, a media innovation pioneer from the MacArthur Foundation. At the board level, we've added 3 new trustees who will help guide and push us into the media future. Joy Ito, who is the director of the MIT Media Lab, John Palfrey of Harvard Law School and Berkman Center, and Facebook co-founder Chris Hughes, who recently purchased and is now publisher of The New Republic. I honestly cannot think of a better way to ensure that we stay focused and alert to change than by bringing together minds like these. To stay closer to the reality of the cycle of innovation, we're now offering 3 Knight News Challenges per year rather than just 1, and we've decided to focus each of the contests on a topic. When we announce our first batch of winners next week at MIT, for example, all of them will be working on projects dealing with the concept of networks. This year's second news challenge is open right now, and the theme is data. We're looking for ideas at the intersection of innovation, information, and community that specifically focus on data. And if you have an idea, look us up online at newschallenge.tumblr.com. We've also started a rapid prototyping program, giving small grants for quick projects that demonstrate concepts. The idea is simply that it's cheaper to build and test, and perhaps fail quickly, to learn and to do it again. Another new idea for us is commercial investment. Our Knight Enterprise Funds now is investing money directly from our endowment in for-profit startups aligned with our mission. We believe that for-profit and nonprofit efforts will complement each other, particularly as organizations seek online sustainability. Look at our grants and you'll see collaborations and partnerships that wouldn't have seemed possible just a few years ago. Mozilla putting text into newsrooms, dozens of, perhaps not in New York, but dozens of online news operations. YouTube with the Center for Investigative Reporting in San Francisco launching together an investigative reporting channel. Google giving us money to support media innovation. We deal with ProPublica 1 minute and Kickstarter the next. Community foundations, literally from Alaska to Puerto Rico, doing grassroots news projects. And top journalism schools modernizing their curricula in collaboration with the Carnegie Foundation. We funded through Drexel University an incubator Drexel University Engineering School, an incubator at the Philadelphia Inquirer. Using all these projects as part of the creative destruction of traditional media in the digital age. The goal is not our satisfaction or security as journalists or as newspeople. It is informed and engaged community, and it is not for the faint of heart. We accept the challenge, and when we see others take it on, as Newhouse has with the Digital Times Picayune in New Orleans, we pay attention to their work with interest, optimism, and high expectations. When I came to Knight Foundation 7 years ago, I discovered perhaps our biggest challenge was letting go. Letting go of the idea that because we were the leading journalism funder, we somehow knew the answers. We had to accept and announce and walk the walk that we did not. And that we and all of us are at the dawn of a new age where technology would change not only habits and practices, but also values and norms. To contribute, to succeed in that world, we had to find an institutional open mind. The Newhouse I3 Award is recognition that we've made some progress in that direction and a challenge to us because there is so much more to do. Thank you very much.
I just want to congratulate all the winners and the finalists. Thank you all very much for coming. I hope you enjoyed it. Pictures will be posted on the website this afternoon. The URL is in your program. I hope to see you again next June. Thanks very much.